In some cases, we may need to create tables to indicate certain information about our drawings. For instance, in a previous lesson, we used bubble leaders to indicate the different parts of an assembly. However, as you can see, the only information those leaders give us is the number of the part. In order to show more information about each part, I can create a table which will contain the name of each part, the number that the part is represented by, and how many are used in the assembly. To create a table, I can either open the Draw menu, or I can click on the Table button in the Annotation panel of the Home ribbon. Once I click on the Table icon, the Insert Table window appears with all the table settings. In the Column and Row settings, I can specify how many rows and columns the table will have. In this example, I will set the number of columns to 3, one for the part number, one for the name, and one for the quantity. So I will change the value in the Columns field to 3. As for the column width, I will set its value to 40. Next, I have to specify the number of the rows. Before I do that, I want you to notice that the field of rows is called Data Rows. Tables in AutoCAD have at least 3 rows, even if I set the value in the Data Rows field to 1. If you look below this section, you can see the Set Cell Style settings, which defines if the first row will be a title row, a header row, or a data row. The same thing happens with the second row. Then, there are the same 3 options for all other row cell styles, which apply to the number of rows I have specified in the Data Rows field. As a result, you have to specify 2 rows less than the actual number of rows you wish the table to have. To get a clearer idea of how this works, let's say that I need a table with 8 rows in total. I will set the value of Data Rows to 6 and change the first row cell style to Header since I do not wish the table to have a title. Next, I will also change the second row style to Data. In the All Other Row Cell Styles, I will also set the Data style. Before I click OK, I should mention that I won't specify a value in the Row Height field because the row height is being adjusted according to the size of the letters. At this point, I will click OK, and as you can see, the table moves along with the cursor until I click again to place it. Once I place it, I will start typing the first header, which is the item number. I can modify the text appearance and justification from the text editor ribbon, like we have learned in previous lessons. By pressing the Tab button, the cell next to the one I edited activates. This time, I will type the word description, and then I will press Tab again to write the last header, which is the quantity. I will close the text editor and double-click on the cell under the item number. I will type the number 1, and then I will press Enter to move to the cell right below, where I will type the number 2. I will continue typing numbers until I reach the last cell of the column and write the number 7. Then, I will fill the second column with the name of its part. The number 1 represents the bushing. Once I write the word bushing, I will press Enter to move to the cell below and write the name of the second part. The second part is the pulley, so I will type the word and press Enter again to move to the name of the next part, which is the bracket. The fourth part is the washer. The fifth, the turn screw. The sixth, the cap screw. And lastly, the seventh, the nut. Once I write each of them in the right cell, I will move on to the quantity. All the parts apart from the nut are used in the assembly once. So I will type the number 1 to all the cells of the column except the last one. Since there are 2 nuts in the assembly, I will type the number 2 in the last cell. Now, in case I want to align the cell contents evenly, I have to select all the cells I wish to align differently first. When I select a cell of the table cell ribbon appears. From the cell styles panel, I will select the middle center justification and notice how the table changes. At this point, I should mention that we can insert or delete rows and columns from the table cell ribbon. For example, I will select the C8 cell and I will insert 2 rows below the 8th line. Similarly, I could have added more columns. Before we finish the lesson, I should mention something quite useful. We can select several neighboring cells and merge them. In this example, I will select the cells of the 9th and the 10th row, then I will expand the merge options, and I will select merge all. Notice that those 6 cells became 1. If I wish to separate the cells again, I can just click on the Unmerge Cells button. Finally, I will delete these 2 rows I created to show you the merge and unmerge options.